Says in conversation with Monica de la Fuente, I'm not Monica. Monica will appear later in the second part of the event. Guillermo has been researching, he's a deep interest in A.K. Ramanujan, one of India's most important writers, translators, scholars, anthropologists, who taught in Chicago University, and Guillermo has been deeply interested in his work and has managed to get access to his personal papers that are with the archives of the Chicago University, and has based his new work and his new book on that material. Probably it's just the tip of the iceberg. There's much more there, obviously. But it's very ironic. A.K. Ramanujan passed away in the year 1993, in rather tragic circumstances. He had gone for a very simple appendectomy at Chicago University's Medical Center, and the anesthesia copped out and it didn't work, and he just passed away in a very tragic and very young age. I used to edit the arts pages of the Economic Times in Delhi those days, and just 2 months before that, A.K. Ramanujan had been in Delhi for attending a seminar at the India International Center, and one of my colleagues, Ayesha Kagal, a brilliant writer from Times of India, had done a long interview with him, and which she had given it to me saying, I don't want this edited, so if there's any space in your paper, a full page available, then would you please carry it? I'll give it to you. At the same time, one of India's finest photographers, Ketaki Sheth, happened to be right there, and she had taken some brilliant pictures of Ramanujan, and she had also given those photographs to me saying, if you're going to use Ayesha Kagal's piece, then you can use these photographs along with it. And I had kept it by for a rainy day when we had a full page available and so on. And then we got this bad news. So I got my team to work on a full page tribute to Ramanujan, laid out the text and the photographs and so on. I just needed a few biographical details, which I had with me at home, but I was living far away from office. It would have taken me an hour and a half to go and come. So I thought the next best thing would be to go to the Sahitya Academy, after all, a well-known Indian writer, and they would have material. So I called the Sahitya Academy librarian, whom I knew, and he was a Kannadiga to boot, so I could almost hear him standing up on the other side of the phone, saying, yes, sir, you're the first media person to call after the passing of this great legendary man, and please come, we have all the material. So I hopped across, it was just 3 minutes away from my office, and he was waiting at the door to receive me, made me sit down in his own chair, walked 10 steps, opened the filing cabinet, pulled out a pink file with big A.K. Ramanujan written on it, and very ceremoniously offered me the file. I opened the file, there was not a scrap of paper in it. It was completely empty. So equally ceremoniously, I closed the file, I gave it back to him, and I said, tomorrow morning when my page appears, I'll come and gift you that page. Please start your fucking file after that. Now, this is the story of the way we keep the memory alive of people like this, the great writers, great authors. Much of it is lost in the way we remember and the way we keep material, the impossibility of archiving in India for some reason. So it's heartening that much of that material is there in Chicago, and scholars who are interested, and others, rustics who are interested, and publishers who are interested, can go there and have access to this. With these few opening words, over to you, Guillermo, and about your book and about your research, and what's the new material that you came across?
Yes. Thank you so much, Sadanand. I'm really happy to be here. It's a very emotional day, because somehow the whole story of how I got involved with Ramanujan turns full circle. This is where it started for me in Chennai, and Monica, who will be dancing. There will be a section after this where we have a little performance prepared in homage to Ramanujan and to the word. We're celebrating the word. I'm not going to talk too much about the book, which was published by OUP, and people who are interested can delve at length into it because it's long enough. It's about 600 pages almost. But I would like to say how I got so mesmerized and so involved in this. It started as a journey. And Monica and I, we traveled overland from Spain. It's a long story, all over Central Asia, Iran, ended up in the Himalayas, went to Khajuraho, and my now present wife, at that time girlfriend, she was struck by the wonderful dance of Alarmel Valley at Khajuraho, and she said, I have to study this dance. So she went up to Alarmel Valley and said, can I learn from you? And Alarmel was at the peak of her career. This was 1993, the same year, same summer that Ramanujan passed away. And she said, well, you know, just come and talk to me. Come to Chennai. So we went all the way down to Chennai. And she was quite busy, but she said, go to Kalakshetra. So she went to Kalakshetra, and there, it was a beautiful campus, but she had to go a kind of audition or something like that. She was 19 at the time and got admitted. It was all like very funny because we were looking for a space to stay. Jumped on a bus to relax and go to Mahabalipuram. And on the way, I just very quickly saw, looking out of the glass, broken glass of the bus, I saw Chola Mandal Artist Village. Wow, what's that? So on the way back, we stopped, walked into this space, which has changed quite a bit, and found this amazing ambiance, walked up to one of the little studios, and somebody was just saying, I was waiting for you. This was KM Gopal. I said, oh, you were waiting for us? We were looking for a place. Yes, I was waiting for you. And he said, you can have the studio, it's 1200 rupees, okay. So we blocked, rented the space. It turned out, we found out months later, that he was waiting for some French couple. We happened to be Spanish. But this is karma, whatever you want to call it. So I got involved in poetry because I was a literature student. I had just done stylistics at Edinburgh University and English literature in Spain. And from the very beginning, the first book I picked up in Benares at a bookshop incidentally run by a Spaniard was Speaking of Shiva, and another book of poems is 10 Indian English Poems. It's an anthology by Partha Sarathi. And I was immediately struck by the depth, the multiple layers, the tricks that Ramanujan played in his poems. You know, they came alive. It was like you started to read a poem. There's this, like this poem, Snakes. Now when you read it, and when you finish reading it, you have to go back and start reading it again because he's played a trick on you. And when you read it in second reading, you bring out another layer, and then these overtones where he plays with the multiple traditions. He plays with his own Kannada tradition, the local tradition, the oral tales around snakes, and his own experiences. It's a beautiful metaphor of his life and his work. And then, of course, all this, you know, Vedic philosophy and the classical around the snake and the Kundalini, it's also there in the poem. But then also all the Western tradition of what the snake means, the biblical, the fall, and D.H. Lawrence. And so just by reading one poem, I was kind of a window opened to India, because all of, you know, us, when we, you know, I was a young student, I was 22 years old, and India is huge and you can get lost in it. And for Monica, it was dance, a way of entering into the culture. And for me, it was poetry. And it was Ramanujan who opened these windows into a completely new, you know, ecosystem of culture, everything there is in it. And then later discovered that he was a translator. Well, I read the Vachana poems, which became a cult book, and then later discovered Interior Landscape, the Tamil Sangam poetry, and only much later I discovered that there was this, he was a scholar. But I just want to end this story by saying that, you know, in Cholamandal Artist Village, I made beautiful friends. I met also in that, at that time, Chandalekha and Sadanand and Padmini Chetur, and Oh, wonderful artists. One of them who's sitting here, Vishwanathan. And, you know, it's so happened. I didn't know at the time that I was going to do a PhD on Ramanujan, which I ended up doing. I joined Loyola College, very close. I did my MA on Indian writing in English, and my entire dissertation was on snakes, on that poem, from a thematic and stylistic point of view. So the entire dissertation, my guide said, what are you doing? I said, well, there's so much in one poem, 100 pages on a poem, it's so deep, so I'll just dissect the poem, you know, from thematic and stylistic, because he was a linguist. So the how, you know, the importance, I think it was Anantamurthy who wrote, an essay after Ramanujan passed away saying, the importance of being Ramanujan. He just happened to be a great poet, scholar, and linguist. When he went to America, he put all of that to use to give us these beautiful translations. He gave these translations as, you know, his own tribute to the traditions and made them available to the West. And it's very important to underline that the bridge was between those traditions and the Western reader at the time, American reader. Because he has to some extent been criticized, and I had this discussion at Sahitya Academy 3 to 4 days ago with Shiva Prakash, who's another Kannada poet, who said, but he wrote too much in the modernist style. He appropriated the tradition. He wrote too much in the Sylvia Plath style. But he was writing in their idiom. So he was not writing to the urban Indian reader of today. He was writing for, he was translating for those readers in the 70s and 80s. The bridge was between Indian tradition and the Western reader. Maybe he should have had two versions, you know, one with for the readers in the West and one for readers here. Could have been.
Yeah, but he was an equally accomplished poet in Kannada and Tamil.
Exactly.
And recognized as such, and where this dichotomy never figures. So it's just the English writing they're talking about. And
of course. He was a bilingual poet, very much recognized as part of the Navya poetry, a follower of, you know, the style that Adiga started, and there were others like Ramachandra Sharma. He did translate very few of his own poems into English and then from English into Kannada. And he was trilingual in the sense that his parents were from Tamil Nadu and he grew up in Mysore with this triple stream, you know, the father tongues, the mother tongues, the metaphor in his house. So his parents spoke to him in Tamil, but he didn't learn formal Tamil until he did linguistics and joined, as a Dravidian professor in the US. So he was teaching English here. He said that was by this kind of perversity, teaching English and Shakespeare in India. And when he was in 1959, became a Fulbright scholar, got a scholarship, joined Indiana University in Bloomington, and did linguistics and was able to do it on Kannada and Tamil. He did a Kannada grammar, you know. So the story somehow has another interesting angle, and that was, I think it was a couple of years later. I had been living in Acholaman for 2 or 3 years, and Vishwanathan gave me this tape of recordings. Are you interested in Ramanujan? He said to me, yes, I've been working on him for 2 years, writing this dissertation. Well, why don't you listen to this? Because Ramanujan, when he came to India on his last trip, December 92, if I'm not wrong, he did this impromptu reading of some of the Alvar translations that he had not published yet. And I believe it was with, there were a few friends around, S.G. Vasudev, who was another friend of Ramanujan, the painter, who later did tribute to Ramanujan. And I was fortunate enough to be given this tape. And there were so many other people I met that felt that what a huge loss. So they encouraged me to study seriously Ramanujan. And among them, I have to mention Girish Karnad, who has written the foreword to the book also, who later encouraged me after I had joined Kerala University to do a PhD, because Monica suddenly said, okay, Bharatanatyam is fine, but now I need a little bit more energy and I need to go into Kathakali. So she joined Kalamandalam and did studies in Kathakali. So there I met Dr. Ayappa Panikkar, who was of the same age group generation as Ramanujan, and to some extent, even a little jealous of Ramanujan, because Ramanujan had been able to make it big in America, and he had stayed back in for other reasons. He had got married and all these things. But Ayyappa Panikkar was one of those other geniuses who was able to connect the South Indian Dravidian tradition with a contemporary and a poet in Malayalam. So because of him, I joined Kerala University, did my PhD, and when I had more or less researched and met everybody that knew Ramanujan, Girish said, no, you have to go to Chicago. And this is where I want to end this introduction. You have to go to Chicago because all the papers have just been handed in to the Special Collections Department. Ramanujan taught at University of Chicago from 1962 till his till he passed away. And I asked my Spanish university for a scholarship, went there. And, you know,
how easy was it to access the Chicago material?
I was quite lucky because they had not been processed yet, but they'd just been opened. So Molly, Ramanujan's ex-wife, because he was still divorced when he passed away, she had put everything in boxes, handed it in. And, you know, when you find papers like this before they are processed, it's much more interesting because you know how Ramanujan has placed things. I've gone back now in September and everything has been put in folders, classified and so on. But the wonderful thing that happened while I was going through the papers is that I found I found some beautiful diaries, amazing diaries. And some of them were tucked away, kind of hidden away, so that nobody could read them, though he was aware.
What do you mean beautiful diaries? What's beautiful about
it? You know, beautiful diaries in the sense that he was a poet, and most of the diaries are about his dreams and his love affairs and, you know, women in his life. There were quite a few of them. But I was interested in how a poet, because that's what the book is about. It's looking at Ramanujan the scholar as a poet, how a poet thinks. How life, the particularities of life, because he was the poet of the particular, how common day experiences were transformed into words, into structures, into, sometimes babies, he called them babies, that he would have to, care for. Sometimes they would just not work out, they become freaks and demons. And sometimes they would turn into beautiful poems. So that process, creative process of a writer, which he would not talk about, you could analyze through, and the connections between what he wrote about himself, because he was not one of those poets who liked to speak about his own poetry. He would not. Some poets have, Ezra Pound, even Nisim Ezekiel. He would not write about his own process. In interview, he didn't like interviews, and he says it there. He was very scared of interviews. And connecting those diaries with his poetry drafts, I talk about his, it's a very rare experience, but he was very obsessed with the idea of Soma in the 70s. But he never published the Soma poems. I talk about them here. And they were somehow triggered by an experience in 1971 when he had just divorced. He went through this 40s crisis. And just like a lot of other people, he just took experimented with mescaline. And Aldous Huxley had done it before, so he kind of imitated. And he said he was walking into his footsteps. And this whole experience that he connected to creativity, how that got into poems. Sometimes it works, but he said, I just want to read a couple of lines here, and maybe we should give way to the performance. First of all, for him, it was like a mystery, the ordinary mystery, he called poetry making. But in terms of translation, he was very clear that he had to be faithful to the original. At the same time, he should let poetry win. So he said, let poetry win, allowing scholarship. Let poetry win without allowing scholarship to lose. So scholarship had to be there. It was all a balance between appropriation and representation, freedom and constraint, the author and the text. So he also quoted another McCarthy saying, a translation or a translator is an artist on oath. He had to be in between. So everything was in between American India, between scholarship and poet, between his own Indian traditions. So this in-betweenness is just very beautiful.
Yeah, thank you. And would you like to read a passage from your book if you want?
Yeah, I will do that in the performance.
In the performance.
But
and those are from the diaries.
From the diaries. Just to summarize this, his stance on translation, I want to read the last stanza of a poem, which is very ironic because he brought the irony in. In fact, you know, he wanted his own poetry to become part of the tradition. He was very much influenced by T.S. Eliot, and he thought that he could inscribe his own poetic work into that tradition. That's why he did this mock poem sometimes, like prayer to Lord Murugan. He was an atheist. He didn't believe. At the age of 16, he threw away his sacred thread, and he was a Brahmin. He shunned, you know, the Brahminic tradition, and that was also there. You know, the tension between the modernism and tradition. Again, another in between us. And at the age of 16, he failed an exam. History exam, and he took a year off, and that year he started writing, and creativity came into him, and his father wanted him to become a mathematician. There was always this interest in science, which he again picked up through linguistics, but his father thought he was not as good as his other brothers. By the way, he's called Ramanujan because his father was very close to Srinivas Ramanujan. He admired Srinivas Ramanujan. That's why he was his second son. He was called him Ramanujan. So the something of that mathematics and science always followed him. So I'll just read this piece, which is, again, very ironic, because that's what he brought in, the modernist ironic element. Of course, we have to say that he went through different phases, modernism and then post-structuralism and that other struggle between structural and post, but I don't want to go into that. Just a few lines on what he thought of translation. This is from Waterfalls in a Bank. And it ends like this. As I transact with the past, as with another country, with its own customs, currency, stock exchange, always at a loss when I count my change.
Just one information, these diary entries, are they all of even length, or they are some days long entries, some days?
He has hundreds and hundreds of pages. First he did it, you know, as something quite mechanical as a young. His first diary entry is from the age of 17, and I found his first draft, you know, where he actually writes about how he wrote his poem, actually his second poem, and I'm going to read from that. So I will start in 49, it's like a journey, and I go into the 70s in what I'm going to read now. But then it became like a therapy. He was very much into psychoanalysis. So this is the whole idea of going into the papers at Chicago University, because that's where we left it. It gave me an insight into the akam. You know, he was interested in inner and outer, the akam and purva. So that's why, you know, somehow this is how the book is based. And the reason it's When Mirrors Are Windows is because he wrote an essay called Where Mirrors Are Windows. So, you know, he played with, he was obsessed with multiple identities, you know, a mirror becoming a window and sometimes reflecting and refracting. That, you know, beautiful phrase that poetry contains, transforms and returns our reality to us, and us to reality in oblique ways, you know. So the multiple identities, the double ganger, that self-portrait poem, so the multiple identities. So the diaries are like, they're becoming like a therapy. And he's aware of sometimes his own self in the diary, and he had this short Kannada novel where he writes about somebody else. It's called Someone Else's Autobiography, which he almost ended up writing in English. I found a few pages only. He wanted to write an autobiographical knowledge in English. And last month, September, I also found his diary on the ship, when he boarded the ship in 1959. I had only found 1.5 pages. I found the whole thing. It's about 50 pages long. I'm discussing with OUP if they want to publish it, when he boarded the ship going from, you know, Bombay to America. So it was a therapy. He had a therapist, and he said, you just, you know, he would write all his dreams, his stories. There are thousands of pages. So you have to seep through all of that material to extract something that has to do with the creative process, which is what we're doing now in the performance. It's a homage to Ramanujan and a homage to the word.
Thank you, Guillermo, for a very compact and very incisive entry into Ramanujan, and we'll make space for Monica.
Mysore, 25th September 1949. A poem is born. He was writing a poem. He had a small, neat hand with rather feminine curves and angles. He admired it secretly, thought of a young worship-eyed posterity, thought of how he shyly concealed all that behind a modest mask of diffidence, which had the trick of becoming agonizingly real too often, the mask growing into the face. He locked all of those thoughts down. They were getting out of hand. He must think of the poem. His second. All of a sudden, the cadence reappeared. Floating embryo soul waiting for the body. Poetry elbowing its way through this whirring, infinitely dreary, lonely press. He should write it soon, have risen earlier. But who was to know that it would appear so exhilaratingly today, so tantalizingly amidst these incalculable little fatalities? Was poetry an antithesis to life, and life a petty hounding tyrant? He wished he could note that down, a sharp thought that. He should make it a point hereafter to carry it with him, always, and note it down. Oh, that strain again, he quoted to himself. There it was again, that wheeling being, that returning intoxication. Ah, that strain again. Unforeseen, the miracle renewed itself in fresher attitudes. Words flooded his brain, and he was in hot intonation. It gave a curious fleetness to the body, and he pranced visibly in pent-up excitement. He was writing a poem. The flowering tree. The garden. Family house. Mysore. Mother. Grandmother. Story. The snake in a hole. Father's books in the attic. My sister. Buffaloes. The river. My glasses. In the mirror. Mirrors. A window. July 1959, somewhere on the Atlantic Ocean from Bombay to Europe to America. Notes towards the journal. The journey. One may begin anywhere. Every journey is a disentanglement, a flutter of adieus among the mast ropes. It dawns so differently in the Atlantic fog, and the sun cheats your tropic watches by setting behind the Seine at 9:30. Even the shape of bread changes. As one is disengaged from the family, the familiar, everything puts on a stranger look of a symbol. The journey itself, the seed's self-exile, the salt estranging sea, the towboat, the guy ropes, the receding wharf with its belittled crowd, its motley of mothers and wives waiting for the emptiness, the sudden need for telescopes. But a ship is a floating island. Its self-sufficiency disturbs you. It has everything except a cemetery. There's always the sea. There's everything here, but everything is anonymous till one sees the faces in the crowd. There's a collective purpose held for 4 weeks. The self-sufficiency is part of that long-term purpose that stands on Staten Island, a finger through the smog. Self-portrait. I resemble everyone but myself, and sometimes see in shop windows, despite the well-known laws of optics, the portrait of a stranger. Date unknown, often signed in a corner by my father. Bennington, Vermont, USA, November 8, 1960. Snow. Cars laden with snow. The sky a reddish glow, the leafless branches trellised against it. The red curve of the red and blue mailbox neatly topped by a heap of white. And a silence, as if the mouths of the world have been muffled. On such days, I look at things about vividly. Feel insensitive and rage at my insensitiveness that cannot register forever all the designs, the color contrasts, the masses with their veins showing. The word looks like a woman, beautiful and inviting, but already someone else's wife. I'm stricken by my lack and feel empty and cheated and frigid before such wealth and warmth. Open, yet close to me. Still another view of grace. Turned and caught the thought by the screams of her hair and said, "Beware, do not follow a gentleman's morals with that absurd, determined air." Find a priest. Find any beast in the wind for a husband. He will give you a house full of legitimate sons. It's too late for sin, even for treason. And I have no reason to know your kind. Red Brahmin among singers of shivering hymns. I shudder to the bone at hungers that roam the street beyond the constable's speed. But there she stood, upon that dusty road, on a night-lit April mind, and gave me a look. Her tumbled hair suddenly known as silk in my angry hand. I shook a little, and took her behind the laws of my land. Meditation. In the course of a meditation, I thought all day I was a black walnut tree. That evening, the golden retriever from the yellow house sniffed me as I stood waiting for the traffic light, lifted its hind leg and honored me with its warm piss. In the rainstorm that night, that tree toppled with a great crash and lay there, its roots an exposition in the sky. The municipality came with electric chainsaws, cut it up in convenient pieces, loaded them in their truck, and took it all somewhere. The carpenter worked with his handsaw, smoothed it with sandpaper, polished it with beeswax, made a butcher block table and a butcher block chair. The paper factory ground up the bark and the leaves into pulp, patted it, bleached it, and turned out rolls of paper with a logo in a watermark. Now, here I sit, in this chair, paper and pencil on my table, and as I write, I know I'm writing now in my head Now on my torso, my living hands moving on a dead one. A firm, imagined body working with the transience of breathless, real bodies. Centuries ago, they said,
my legs are pillars, my body the shrine, the head, the cupola of gold. Listen, O Lord of the meeting rivers, standing shall fall, but the moving ever shall stay.
I didn't know till now, and they didn't know then. I was a phrase from their poem. A fiction made on their lips, as they are now, here, on mine. October 30th, 1976. I've never thought of myself as a writer. I just write. I'm startled when someone introduces me in print or in conversation as a poet. One is a poet only in the poem. Poets are specialists in what everyone does all the time. It isn't true that once a poet, always a poet, and everywhere a poet. Then the poet becomes a poet with capital P. He, she pontificates, sometimes even in the poems. He begins to live like a poet, writing his life and living his writing. The suffering self and the writing self, bhava and rasa, become one, fused, confused. The results, often brilliant, but usually disastrous to both life and art, are well known. The Striders. And search for certain thin-stemmed, bubble-eyed water bugs. See them perch on dry capillary legs, weightless on the rippled skin of a stream. No, not only prophets walk on water. This bug sits on a landslide of lights and drowns. Eye deep into its tiny strip of scry, and drowns eye deep into its tiny strip of sky. The black hen. It must come as leaves to a tree or not at all, yet sometimes it comes as the black hen with the round red eye. On the embroidery, stitch by stitch, dropped and found again. And when it's all there, the black hen stares with its round red eye, and you're afraid. October 30th, 1976. The poems too, when they come, surprise me. I feel a poem has chosen me, not me the poem. And this is not being mystical. I have the same feeling about thoughts, ideas, events, persons. Maybe even a certain passivity, a need to say, I didn't work for it, I'm not responsible, in my nature. For years, I took the Buddhist slogan, take nothing that's not given, literally. Except I reversed it to, take everything that's given, or say no to nothing, which landed me in a dreadful dilemmas with food and women. Poetry happens unbidden and has to protect itself. The psychedelic experience taps precisely such experiences, but the junkies seek it as a separate state, not as an interruption of the ordinary. Perhaps that is what all grace is all about. And this is where the ironic distance comes in. My point is, you can't seek such a state. You can't organize it or take a pill for it. In my Soma poems, for instance, the extraordinary occurs in a most ordinary fashion. Something like the way a poem happens. It's a mystery, but mystery itself is ordinary. Only we make of it something miraculous. Jazz poem for Soma. Soma, why Soma? Soma is not Vishnu. Soma, no mimic similar, has no similitude, grows ordinary as mystery, ancient familiar, the always here. Soma is the same as you and you and you. When you make the right mistake and find your best attitude. So, poets, beware.
Poets, beware. Your life is in danger. The Lord of Gardens is a thief, a cheat, master of illusions. He came to me, a wizard with words, sneaked into my body, my breath, with bystanders looking on, but seeing nothing. He consumed me, life and limb, and filled me, made me over into himself.
Translations too, being poems, are never finished, only abandoned. In a way, one needs the other, even if it's the mocking other, to find oneself. The English language in America itself has been that other, which has returned us to our dream, my discovering Tamil poems in Chicago Library. As a translator, one translates to repossess one's past, not only to realize the pastness of the past, but the presence of the past. But it's in America, the other, that I learned to do it. Though I had begun much earlier. In this business of translating and retranslating from one tradition to another, funny things happen.
$10 was
to the devotees who say, wizard, you took on the forms of swan, fish, tortoise, and man-lion. Show me your grace. He shows his grace, our Lord of Vidavimbe. About him, the chieftain of Thirumangai town, with its great, long-standing buildings, our Arabar who carries a superb spear, has sung these songs in his gifted voice. Anyone who sings them will wash off stains forever.
In Chicago when Ramanujan was there, but to my great sadness, I never met him, so I've been trying to discover him ever since, and I have to congratulate you. This is, as far as I know, the first session on poetry that is in this Lit for Life, and you've really done it justice. Since I live that life in Chicago, when I read his collected poems, I see him there in Chicago, wandering the streets and trying to figure out, what am I doing here? And this whole idea of his double life and being in one place and being someone else and trying to figure out what he's doing, you brought that out very beautifully. So thanks.
Thank you.
Thank you. My name is Josie. I'm an associate professor of English literature from Kerala. Somebody who's been reading Ramanujan and also teaching his poetry, you know, I just want to thank you so much for this wonderfully done, beautifully executed reading of Ramanujan's life and poetry. Especially in the last part where you were quoting lines from his poetry. I was just struck by one poem that I'm teaching right now, the Striders. You know, in Kerala, in Malayalam, that insect is called Vellathil Aashan, And Achan in Malayalam means master. With all the possible connotations, you know, the reference to the prophet and all that. It was brilliant. And ma'am, your performance, I just want to thank you, that's all. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
My name is Innamburan. I saw the divine in Monica. I wish AKR was here. Because I knew the day things happened. Because the day before in California, he was with a friend of mine. Life ebbs and flows. Thank you.
Thank you.
You know, a creator, an artist, is there through the work. So he's very much there, and he's very happy to be here.
Mucho gracias.
Introduces.
I am Anantha Giri with the Madras Institute of Development Studies. Thank you so much. This creative border crossing and kind of overflow of poetry and the performative inspires one to explore this border crossing between poetry, performance, and philosophy in Ramanujan's work. If you both comment upon it, especially the way Ramanujan works with literature as a mode of the performative, where the performative was not just an occasion for reproduction, but performative as a space of the manifestation of the potential.
Since there's not much time, it's a complex question, but just very simply and briefly, Ramanujan was interested in the oral, you know, the oral tradition. So he wanted his poems to be conversational, you know, like flow, like conversational as a conversation. And that came both from his modernist influence as well as the deep involvement with the oral traditions, where, as you know, when you transmit, you know, the borders are blurred, always blurred. It's not clear whether it's poetry, it's performance, dance, music. You don't have those categories in oral traditions. I mean, you know very well in Tamil Nadu, in the South, storytelling. So, and he was also interested in magic, you know, the playing magic tricks. So that suddenly you're surprised. So a poem for him had to be performed. It was a performance. So how do you perform a poem? You use language, you use words. So words had to be, you know, doing something to you. They had to, you know, explode, implode. And as a metaphor, and this is the second aspect to answer your question, for him it was female, you know, grace and inspiration. And he quoted Krauss, a German Austrian philosopher, saying, language is that universal whore that everyone wants to turn into a virgin. You know? So to him, the word came as a female body. It's a body. So in all his poetry is about text and body, which later is very much Roland Barthes also, no, tissue. So words, language and body is complete, it's one. It's to him, and he, this is how he imagined it. And sometimes they would be like demons that could hurt. They could be kind, soft babies, the poems, but they could also be demons like the Black Hand, and or they could be very fragile, and then if you think too much, you drown like the Striders. So the idea of working with Monica, because, you know, this is how we created this, it's all there in his work, but you have to, you know, express it to the audience. You have to embody it. So we have the body.
At the same time, it's something, once you come from, I was 19 when I came to India, I think all those years, you discover that, I mean, you know that. It's in your culture. You know all those connections are there. Sometimes you have to just go out, go away and tell you again, but or someone from outside that sees from out. But I think all that is not new for you. It was for me when I came.
I think the South Indian culture are the masters in combining like the padam, no?
Mm, yeah.
Expression, poetry and text. I think you are the masters. And
when we were meeting Ayappa Panike, because we used to go, both of us, he would not separate a conversation with him or with me. It would be a flowing thing. He would sing, he would, you know, dance if he could, but for me, he was a great master that brought us together.
Yeah. You should not separate the intellectual and the performative. It's a big mistake. He knows a lot about that.
I'm Shweta. First, I want to thank you, both of you, for that wonderful reading and that performance. It was actually a fusion of bhava and essence. I would like to know, as from you, that since already you have done such an extensive reading and studying of Ramanujan's poems, can you please elaborate on the image of the black hen?
It's one of those, he called them, we don't have much time, but he had a group of poems which he called his fear poems. You know, it's the fear of not being able to create another poem. But there's a little more than that, because this is one of his last poems. You know, the Striders, the poem which he composed in the early 60s. In fact, it was based on a poem that was written before he came to the US. That had a first stanza, which was, it was called Fear. And, you know, it's there on the cover of the book, in fact. And then, you know, he starts in media races, in the middle of things, and then, you know, the Strider, the insect comes. So it's one of his fear poems. You know, what are his fear poems? His fears as a poet, you know, every creator has this fear of not being able to receive this grace or the ordinary, and that he would not be able to write another poem, or that it would just turn wrong, and that anguish and that anxiety is there, and it's, you know, it's meta poetry, it's a meta poem. But towards the end of his life, there's a little more to that, because he was suffering from a lot of pain and he had this problem in his spine, and so it's also a little bit of the fear of death, so it's also a symbol of death. But the poem itself, the motif is, you know, stitch by stitch it's a poem about creating the work of art. You know, where suddenly the image appears. As you know, he was an imagist. He was very much influenced by Ezra Pound. So the image and the poem is a metaphor, and then the animal. The animals are everywhere.
Good evening, sir. I'm Satyendra. I have an MA Kannada Literature, and I'm a college mate of Shiv Prakash. And also have an MA philosophy. Actually, I've written some articles on Basavanna in Kannada. And my question is, congratulations for a lovely performance. The question is, it's very difficult to translate all the poems, the vachanas, because they're very, very, very mystical, and you have to know the cultural linguistics and everything. For example, if you say Harakeya Kuri, I have so much of visual information as a person from Karnataka and everything. So it's very difficult to do translation. I'm not read Speaking of Shiva, but I tell, are you studying Kannada, sir?
I've been able to go through the poems with friends who are bilingual.
Okay.
I'm not that familiar with this original Kannada poems.
Uh-huh.
I've read most of them in translation. I've gone through the translations with scholars.
Uh-huh.
And all I have to say is that, of course, he chose the poems that suited his own.
Mm.
There was a selection process.
Mm.
I mean, he dropped those poems which he thought unsuitable maybe for translation.
Mm.
And every translator is an artist on oath, as he said, but you have to translate, you choose. I mean, there's a selection process.
Mm.
And, you know, there's been a lot of controversy of whether he appropriated that tradition and which poems he did not choose, but it's a long issue. It's a
you might have misunderstood. He has not translated
Ramanujan. No. Ramanujan translated. What I'm telling, even for Ramanujan, it's very difficult.
Yes.
Without reading, I'm telling.
No argument. No argument. Otherwise, I think we can bring to a conclusion this wonderful.
Thank you very much.